honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air, number 102. You know, we've been here before, many times. Can't you remember? Maybe that's a problem, not remembering samsara. But we'll go up and set up the camera.
Friends. How are the seven links to awakening fulfilled? Once in Savatthi, the Blessed Buddha said this. How Ananda and the four foundations of awareness trained and developed so that fulfill the seven links to awakening. Whenever Ananda, a bhikkhu, is reflecting upon the body only as an accumulation, not on that very occasion, unconfused and undistracted awareness is established in that bhikkhu. Therefore, on that occasion, the awareness linked to awakening is aroused, and it gradually develops. It reaches a fine fulfillment in that bhikkhu. Dwelling thus aware, he investigates and examines that state by understanding. Whenever Ananda, a bhikkhu, dwells investigating any state, on that occasion, the investigation linked to awakening is aroused. And it gradually develops by many repetitions, and it reaches fulfillment in that bhikkhu. When he investigates phenomena using keen intelligence, examines them, his energy is aroused without any slackening. On that occasion, the energy linked to awakening is enlivened, and it gradually develops by many reiterations. He comes to reach find fulfillment in that bhikkhu. When his enthusiastic energy is aroused, there arises in him a rapturous joy. On that occasion, the joy linked to awakening is instigated, and it gradually develops by many renewals. Then it comes to find fulfillment in that bhikkhu. Both the body and the mind becomes tranquil in whomever is mentally elated by joy. On such occasion, the tranquility linked to awakening is therefore induced, and it gradually develops by maturation. It reaches fulfillment in that bhikkhu. In one whose body is tranquil and who is happy, the mind becomes concentrated. On that occasion, the concentration linked to awakening is self-stimulated, and it gradually develops by training. It reaches fine fulfillment in that bhikkhu. He then just looks on this concentrated mind with imperturbable equanimity. On that occasion is therefore induced the equanimity linked to awakening, and it gradually develops by rehearsal, and it reaches fulfillment in that bhikkhu. It is Ananda. When the four foundations of awareness are trained and refined in exactly this very way, that they fulfill the seven links to awakening. Four, thus fulfilling seven. Four, thus fulfilling seven.
This seeing samsara to the fullest extent for example, 400,000 lives in 4 hours. This is a part of the process of enlightenment for all beings. And this usually happens at the first 4 hours of the night of enlightenment for the Samasam Buddhas. And if it's Tivita, the three knowledges, Arahants, then it also happened usually early in the morning at the three first hours. So mind is thereby, it's like dreaming. You can dream 3 months in 7 seconds, but in the dream, the subjective time is perceived as going in normal speed. So also this fast forward of mind, see all these past lives, whether as animal or as deva or as human or as ghost or as hell being, they see all these past life pass by with the same detail, color and intensity, vividness, as you see this video. And everything is remembered. It is stored out in space, it's not stored in the brain. All information is for past event is in space. So it is stored right here and right there and basically everywhere. But here is a good stone where we'll sit and record the video here in this small groove of broken trees that displays considerable impermanence, just like us. So here we are again in the forest, and now a new place where we'll talk about this Dhamma on Air number 202, and we'll talk about past life remembrance as the main subject, because this is the main question today. So, past life remembrance, or remember as former existences, pubbe-nivāsānussati. Contemplation of these former existences. This is one of the superhuman forces, actually a superhuman force, four of the apinas, the direct knowledges, as they are also called. So it's a special ability, and it can be found on the link I give below, whatbuddhasaid.net, four superhuman force four. That's described in detail. And the question 304, I'd like to say again, any questions after 290, please resend them to my email, bhante.samahita.gmail.com, so you get on the list again, because I lost the file with another computer. So the standard description of what this is, to remember past life, to the fullest extent, not in a partial or incomplete way that we'll talk about later. It goes like this. He remembers many of his prior lives, one rebirth, two rebirths, three lives, four lives, five lives, 10 lives, 20 lives, 30 lives, 40 lives, 50 lives, 100 past lives, 1,000 prior lives, several hundred thousand lives, many eons, universal cycles of contraction, what we call today Big Crunch, and many eons or universal cycles of expansion, Big Bangs. So we can conclude that the Buddha knew about the non-steady state of the universe, that it's expanding from the Big Bang and then expanding rapidly and accelerating the expansion as it is now, and then after probably something like 70 to 80 billion years, it starts contract again because of gravity. And then it ends in a big crunch. So expansion and contraction, the Buddha knew about that. We first knew about that in the 1930s.
more than 2,000 years, 2,500 years after the Buddha's death. So how could he know that without a spectrometer to measure the redshift of the light? When galaxies move away, their light become more red. And this is, means the hydrogen spectra is moved to the red side. How could he make such a measurement without a spectrometer? It's impossible. And he didn't even have a telescope either. So this says something about their range. It is impossible to say anything about the range of the knowledge of the Buddhas. Impossible. If one tries, then either confusion or madness occurs. So this one should, of course, be extremely careful about. Nevertheless, he remembers his past life for these many universal cycles, like this. There, such was my name, species, family, such was my appearance, such was my food, such my experience of pleasure and pain, and such was my life. Passing away from there, I was reborn elsewhere. There, such was my name, species, family, and such my appearance. Such was my food, such was my experience of pleasure and pain, and such was my life length. Passing away from there, I was reborn here. Thus he recollects his manifold various past lives in all their minute specific details. And the question then goes like this. Can you explain how to review your past life? Can one want to see future rebirth? And see, does thus reviewing require jhana? Yes, to take the last one first, to the fullest extent that this guy remembers in all their minute details, then it actually requires fourth jhana. Because happiness requires you go into the fourth jhana and emerge from there. And then you start reviewing, looking back in time. Regarding seeing future rebirth, I have not seen any examples of it, except Anuruddha, which was a master of mindfulness, that he is said to have reviewed 100,000 eons into the future. But he was also an enlightened person. And I not made other examples. And you cannot say he saw his own rebirth, because he didn't have any rebirth at that time as an enlightened Arahant. So I not made any example of the Txt that anybody could see the rebirth. However, there's plenty of examples of people who can see some kind, various degrees of the future. For example, the time point, predict the time point with accuracy, where they should die, when they should die, and where they should die, under which circumstances. So this is fairly common. And this is called precognition in modern psychology. And I think we can all do that to some extent. Because some part of future is fixed now. It has a probability of one of occurring. And this part one can see. Other parts will have less than one. This have 70% chance, 50% chance, 30% chance. If it's 30% chances and there's 100 other possibilities sharing the 70 remaining percent, then I think it will be very difficult to see. It will be fairly fuzzy. So it is less deterministic when it's not determined. But a determined future and mixed probabilistic future is mixed up, and it's fairly rare events that are completely locked and determined now. So we can't change our own future. So it's not destiny. And that's good news, actually. Otherwise, the noble life and mental purification, an improvement of one's own future, will be impossible. But it's not so. We can change most future. And we can modify or bend or reduce other kinds of future. Though we cannot kind of like completely prevent certain outcomes. So, how actually does one come to see this future? How is the description of this pubbe-nivāsānussati? Yes, this is It's described like this, and the monk who comes home, he goes out to the Pindabat, and he brushes his teeth, wake up, goes out to Pindabat, and then when he comes home, then he washes his bowl and set it aside, and then he sit down, and then he goes up to the first, to the second, to the fourth, third and fourth jhana, emerges from the fourth jhana, and then he take up, advert his attention, redirects his mind to exactly the moment when he came back and put down his bowl before sitting down. And then he starts backtracking from there. So he backtracks, what route did I went on Pindabat? How did I eat? What route did I went on Pindabat on begging round? Which houses were? Until he comes to the morning where he was sitting meditating, until he comes to the night where he was sleeping for 4 hours in the lion's posture on the right side, knee against knee, ankle against ankle, right palm under the head. Until yesterday where he was also striving up and down, walking meditation, sitting meditation, until 10 o'clock at night, until everything that happened yesterday, and then the day before that, and then the day before that. And he keeps backtracking with all the details. And this you can do in the fourth jhana because there's no distraction. This means that if you set the mind on a certain task, then it will fulfill this task perfectly. Secondly, if he stops after a certain while, after a certain number of days, then he starts there again wherever he stopped last time. It's just like it's cutting down a tree, like one of these trees here. When you start chopping and then go home for dinner, then whatever you have cut out of branches the day before, you don't need to cut them away again. So you start where you were the day before, day 33 before this day. Minus 33, you can say, huh? And then minus 1 year, minus 2 year, until one comes to one's baby age. And then until one keep backtracking until one comes into the womb. Then at the transmigration moment, where one has passed the state of a womb, then comes a crucial stage where one cannot discern any individual. There's only mentality and materiality, nama rupa, which is actually activities. Because nothing is static in early Buddhism. There's only activities. There's no entities. No stable, static, same, lasting entity. There's not. It's part of seeing no self is seeing that there is no entities, no things that are the same from one moment to the next moment. And therefore everything is dynamic. And therefore everything is a process, basically. Processes have properties, but they don't have any static entities in them, nor between them, inside them, outside them, anywhere to be found. So this flow, this flux of mentality and materiality, it has to be defined. And it's said that it is especially important to define nama rupa, mentality and materiality, minding and mattering. Define that before this happens, because otherwise one cannot pass the transmigration. One comes to a point where there's nothing to see, basically, if one cannot define, delineate nama rupa, mind and matter, minding and mattering as processes, mentality and materiality. One cannot go beyond that stage. And this means one cannot travel back to the former life and see where it comes from, what it is, basically. It's said that some Buddhas there are especially good to it, and they can easily review 100,000 eons, sometimes 400,000 eons, sometimes 1,600,000 eons, backward in time. But Pacheka Buddhas can do something less. Akasavakas, the prime disciples, can do something less, but even sectarians like Hindus, who are good meditators, can also do to some extent. And also Savakas, normal disciples that have no access to fourth jhana, can do something. That is to remember either shadows of one life or one life complete, or the important events in one life, or the important events in several lives, in the order of 1 to 5, a handful of lives. But already that sets things in a completely new perspective. Why so? Because then you see that you are walking in circles. Here, there, there. You can recognize your own tendency for what you did in the first life to what you did in this life. So, actually, we are remembering all our tendencies, Latin tendencies, and who, what we prefer, yogurt, or this spouse, or that spouse, or going out in nature, or living half a life as a layman, and then ordaining late in life. All this is something that is subconscious to us, why we do it. But in many cases, it's remembrance, remote remembrance, subconscious, partial remembrance of things we've done many times before. Usually having the same spouse several hundred times, meeting the same people. So you and I have probably met many times before in the same role, basically. So the question is, then when one sees that to the fullest extent, does it make sense to go in circle? In this circle, and then another circle, and then another circle. For each circle being in complete oblivion about what happened in the other circle. When you see that what happened in the other circle is more or less the same as what's happened in this circle, then it starts to become absurd, grotesque. And the news value of it, the temptation of it, the fact that for each being that are deeply, as the Buddha say, deeply in love with themselves, this life seems to be captivating them from day one to they start suffering so much that they are in constant pain at the age of whatever they do that. So this going in circle, one has to see, come to see, that this is going in circle. There's no novelty here. We've eaten before, going to the toilet before, had children before, had economic troubles before, billions of billions of billions of times. The only thing we have not done before was breaking free of samsara, becoming enlightened. This we didn't do in any of the prior existences. Despite the fact that that's the only thing that can bring lasting happiness. And even approaching at whatever level of mental release, stemming from this dispassion, this detachment, this disillusion with going in circles, which is basically seeing the monotony as absurd, as grotesque, as irrational. The monotony of daily life, of economic dependency, going to work every day, doing the same, up and down the doorway, whether it's rational or not, knowing that it's sometimes irrational, because you have to do it, you sold your soul to your boss, and your search for pleasure, and housing, and so on, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. So it's seeing this not only as banal, but as or trivial, and thereby boring to some extent, but seeing it then little by little as first absurd and then grotesque, then one starts to turn away from it, because the craving towards this is fading away, viraga, fading away, and then one turns away from it and turns towards nibbana. And it's there the Noble Eightfold Way starts and restarts in each life. It's right there by this turning away, not looking for alternatives to jump over the low fence and design a new route in samsara, a new pleasure hunting in samsara that is basically the same circle as all the other circles, at least the circles in Brahmaloka, in the lower 12 levels of existence. Not constructing a new circle, not forming new intention, hopes, plans, but turning away from the whole gamut. Why so? Because one sees it and knows it as being suffering. only. And that any craving for it, any planning for it, any hoping for it, it is the cause of this very suffering. Then one can let it be. It's like coming along a way, and then you see there's a purse with $1,000 in it. Then you don't pick it up. You don't pick it up and start clinging to it. You see, I don't need that. I know what it is in advance. I know what's long, long tribulation, dependency, attachment. What this spells, it spells frustration, long-term frustration. There's small blips of happiness inside there, yes, true. But there's certainly also a lot of trouble connected with it. Huh? Just look at your own life from day to day. So seeing this, one turns away from it, and there the path starts. So to whatever extent one cannot reach the fourth jhana, but one can get shadows of it during meditation and seeing some events. Unfortunately, it's often difficult to see whether these shadows are, and also during dreaming, these shadows are real or not real. That's the tricky part of discriminating them from fantasies, wishful thinking, paranoia, and what have you of this kind of mental construction that is not real. However, that said, does free fantasy, completely free fantasy exist? No, doesn't exist. Fantasies are also conditioned events. So they are mixed up of very remote memories, because you can also sometimes remember something that happens and happened many times during the whole samsara. And these events will then be mixed up and colored by each other, and then form these tendencies, latent tendencies, anusaya, which conditions and pushes and shapes these fantasies. So all fantasies has some level of reality in it, but not the level one is looking for this interesting prior lives that is within the range of the last 10 lives, for example. And ultimately speaking, the one that was ultimately prior to this one. I often get the question, if one remembers people that remember either doing hypnotic regression or as children, then why do they only remember human life? And I think it's because human life is more vivid than a worm life and an insect life, which maybe only lasts 20 days or 30 days. So you cannot remember much from these lives, just as you cannot remember much from being anesthetized or sleeping. So if you are born a human, then I think you have a tendency to remember human events that human lives normally contain. Especially if you're ripped out of life early on during an accident or killing or murder or something like that in an early age where you're not ready for it. And your ability to remember is very vivid. You don't have any senile dementia, then one can remember some events. If, however, when these children that usually are 2 to 6 years old, when they grow up and become, and that's 2,500 there of them on a website Jan Stevenson had made, started collecting these cases in 1960, the year I was born, and so they're very well documented. And they, when they're 8 of 10, they can usually not remember anything anymore. So it leaves the possibility open that we also could remember something. But we were not aware that what we could remember there when we were 2 to 6, that actually was prior lives. And then we start going to school and learning a lot of things and playing and all the world samsara with its manifold details. It kind of like washes out these memories. Because you have to forget something. You can only have a certain amount of bits in there. So forgetting is normal, otherwise you will remember everything instantly, and that's very disturbing, actually. So it's kind of a pity that we don't remember prior lives, but this is what we will have to deal with, you can say. The next question goes on whether offering to the Hindu gods like Vishnu and Ganesh, it actually is some part of Buddhist praxis. And the Buddha said about these other devas that are real. Sakya, for example, called Indra in Hinduism, is definitely he's a Buddhist, and also to worship him and give him gifts and so on is definitely a Buddhist praxis. But should we give flowers and so on? Yes, it's up for discussion, offering fruits and money, and what do we gain as a result? Do they play a role in these offerings that you can see in Hindu temples, and sometimes also, especially on Sri Lanka, also on Buddhist temples, usually a little bit in the background? Do they play a role in Buddhism? The Buddha say that you should be good towards even earth devas and house devas that live.
So the Buddha says that being good to the neighbors, including other devas from other religions, being good to everyone indiscriminately is a good thing. It goes with the saying in Australian territory where there's very arid, you should be good toward all corners, because if you lose the water in your place, then you have to go to your neighbors and get water there. So obviously this is a part of Buddhist practice, not for worshipping Hindu gods, but for being good towards all beings and your neighbors in general. Question 317. Is reaching the first jhana enough for the Brahmaloka rebirth even without jhana yet enjoyed at the death moment? No, this is not enough. So Brahmaloka can be reached only if you can reach the first jhana as a minimum at the moment of death, the Txt moment. And that, of course, is dependent upon whether one has mastered this first jhana before one approaches the moment of death. And if one has pain at the moment of death, then one should master it fairly good, because you have to go into it, you have to find joy and pleasure to the extent that you can enter the first jhana, and you have to do that despite of the bodily pain before entering. So only in the first jhana at the Txt moment, one will get access to level 12 or upwards, the Brahmaloka. However, that said, this is dependent upon how much you can get first jhana. If you can, for example, become so skilled that you enter the first jhana, before you start, you can determine the duration up to 7 days. Let's say you determine the duration to be 24 hours before you lie down on your deathbed. Then you go into the first jhana. You will not be able to speak to anyone there, of course, at your deathbed. But nevertheless, you determine to be 24 hours. Then one is almost sure to go in there. And it's something that the Buddha said to Sariputta and to others that were invited out to Hindus to give a speech, Dhamma speech, on their deathbed. That is to induce one of the Brahmaloka, Brahma Viharas, the four Brahma Viharas, Metta, universal friendliness, Karuna, universal compassion, mutual joy, Mudita, and Upekka Parami, to follow them all the way up to either the first, second, third, or fourth jhana, so they can be united with the Hindu gods that they, in this case, Brahma, Mahabrahma, that they worship. But nevertheless, still, it is dependent upon being able to access first jhana either in the death moment itself or in the moment just before that. And that determines whether one can attain Brahmaloka rebirth. So much for today. Subscribing to this YouTube channel down in the corner, down there, is your ticket to Nirvana. Thanks for your advantageous kusala attention, clever consideration, and kind contribution. Thanks to all the Dayakas, supporters and donors, especially those who are regular every month, because the price level here in Denmark is considerable, I have to say. So thank you very much for supporting these videos and this work. And you can do this on whatbuddhasaid.net eller on Patreon, and just search for my name, Samahita. Lastly is just to say, as we usually do, Nam. Tassu. Bhagavattu. Arahattu. Samma Sambuddhasa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the best Buddha. And have a nice and noble day. Can you remember anything? Have you seen this before? Have you seen this guy before? Have you been in this or similar circle before? I think so. You know, we should stop going around this circle. It's absurd. It's grotesque. It's suffering. It's without any meaning. It's deeply irrational. When there is light, you see, there's plenty of light. Why don't we seek the light? The happiness, the lasting happiness of the death is element called the God. Thank you for your attention and have a nice.
Thank you for your attention, contribution, and patience. Thank you also for being a good Buddhist friend by subscribing, clicking the bell, and clicking the like button. And may you have indeed a nice and noble day by remembering silence is bliss. 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 Namo Tassu Bhagavattu Arahattu Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Indeed, yeah. So be it.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pampalela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.